performance analysis, which I think is probably more relevant. So that's my opinion, but I will come through to I will come back to video and the use of video at the end of the presentation. So performance analysis, that's what we're going to look at. So what's your impression of what that actually entails? What is performance analysis in your view?
Understanding how your players play, looking at what they did well, what they didn't do, so on a particular match, why they won it, why they lost it.
And what sort of factors are you looking to cover when you're saying why they won and why they lost? Give me some examples. Pretty straightforward, but what sort of things would you look at?
Where did they win points? How did they win those points? Particular shots?
Yeah.
Physical.
What if? Physical.
Decision making.
Tactical, decision making, so mental, can we call that mental, is that okay? So physical, tactical, mental, technical. What else?
I would look emotional too to see how the player is actually on court, whether their focus seems to be there or not, whether their points, parts in the actual game that they seem to go down in.
Are we going to call that mental?
Yeah.
Mental strength, mental attitude, okay, we'll put that in the mental box. Anything else? Any other areas that you want to look at under the performance analysis? Things that affect anything, now let's broaden it, change the question slightly. What type of things affect performance? So outside of those four things, mainly on court, you're talking on court.
Environment.
So what do you mean by environment?
The noise of
what guys were talking about the other day. What's happening?
What's the fifth performance factor? We have technical, tactical, physical, family life. What's the other?
Family life, yeah. I mean, yeah. So let's put something in there called lifestyle. Mm-hmm. And what sort of things would you put in lifestyle? What sort of areas? So you're all working with young athletes. What sort of things actually do on a daily basis affect your athlete's ability to train or your ability? Exams, good.
Sleep.
Relationships, both family and non-family.
Diet,
very good. Nutrition.
Exercises.
Use my iPad.
Social media.
Any others?
Health.
Good. Keep them coming.
Education.
Education. That's good. Education.
Social media, meaning whether they had any positive or negative.
So,
what's been on them?
Social media is certainly in there when you get up to a reasonable level. Yeah, social media. So, if you take your athlete at the very beginning, who actually owns the project of this kid down here? Who's got ownership of that badminton project when they start? Parents. Parents, yeah. And we'll come back to that in a minute. But parents are obviously a big influence in terms of lifestyle. For the younger athletes, when they start, parents have a big influence on what happens in terms of lifestyle. So a lot of the factors that you've said there, for young children, the parents are actually in control of those, not the children. And that's something that you need to understand very clearly when you're pitching what you expect in terms of lifestyle. Very often the children are not yet in control of that situation. Okay? So, how would you, what is the relevance to your situation? I think we've sort of covered that by that list. How do you prioritise it as a coach when you're trying to build a programme to develop your athlete? How do you prioritise those different areas? How do you view your responsibility as a coach? It's a very broad question, so you can come in from any angle you like. There's no right and wrong.
I like the approach of using like the black box, meaning that the training time is training time.
Yeah.
You put the things that are going on outside. outside of your badminton in that black box and then you come back to it. But often that will come, I notice that especially with young females, but often be half in training, half out of training. And using that ability to let them leave things behind and then come back to them after training session. I'll bring them in.
But so as coaches, which bits, at very beginner level, which bits do you control at the beginning? Which bits have you got, and which bits do you influence at the beginning of the session, at the beginning when you've got young athletes? Where's your area of influence?
On court.
As that progresses, what happens to your responsibility? It broadens. So your role actually broadens. Possibly, you could argue that the parent's role actually diminishes slightly. So you've got this sort of inverted sort of curve line there of influence, where the influence is possibly slowly handed over from parents to the coach.
Yeah.
Where does it go from there? Where does the responsibility go from there? What's the next step? To the player. So eventually, who do you want to own the project?
Player.
Okay. So it starts off as probably parent. Probably comes round to the coach. Then eventually you want that ownership to be taken by the player and the player to actually own their own project. Agreed? Okay, so in terms of your prioritisation, it depends at what stage you're at on that line as to what you're going to prioritise and what your influence is on the programme. Are we all happy with those principles? Okay, then I'm going to broaden it out a little bit. This is one of my favourite quotes of all time. If you don't know why you failed, how can you improve? If you don't know why you succeeded, it must be an accident.
Fair enough.
Is everybody happy with that?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay. How much analysis do you do with your player as to why they're not successful in certain situations? You're all looking when they lose, you're all looking why, yeah? You're all looking why they've lost. You do a certain amount of analysis, presumably, on where their weaknesses are, so that you can build a program here. What about the other side of it? If you're working with a successful athlete, as our boy here is, how much analysis do you do of how they've succeeded? Why they succeeded?
It's equally as important.
It's equally as important, but I would argue that most coaches, probably the balance is not there. Okay? But that's for me is an important quote. It's a guiding quote for me in my work, certainly over the years when I was working more with players. But even working with coaches now, it guides in terms of being analytical. If you're not analytical in the coaching situation, you're probably not going to be successful, and it probably is going to be an accident if you actually do well with the player, or your player as well. Or maybe it's not even your influence. So, 19 all in the third set. What sort of things influence whether they're actually going to win or lose in that situation?
Fitness.
Coach at the back of the court.
I would definitely.
Coach at the back of the court. Fitness. Mental. Decision making, yeah, give you decision making. Very often the top level influence from here, by the way, the decision making. Yeah. What else?
Self belief,
so yeah, that's the mental side.
Nutrition,
you said it earlier. Nutrition at 19 all in the third, what fuel you've got left in the tank is pretty important. You can actually be really fit, but if you haven't got the nutrition side right, you can't apply that fitness. So actually, that balance is right. You can do all the training in the world, but if you get the nutrition wrong, you don't get the benefit. Yeah, strength and conditioning, so more sort of strength and conditioning type stuff. Probably the analysis of your opponent, knowing what your opponent probably does in those situations. So actually having studied your opponent You know, what do they get aggressive at 19 or in third? Do they become passive? Are they nervous? Do they try to play quicker? Do they try and slow it down? If you know some of the habits of your opponent, it's quite interesting to know. There's some analysis. Probably at 19 or in third, depending on what round it is, you probably had to have some recovery in between matches, so there's some physio influence possibly. Certainly stretching and recovery from previous matches will come into play at 19 all. Did you recuperate well and do all of your recovery stuff in between matches in terms of nutrition, stretching, rest? Rest, not going outside with the guys and having any foot in between matches, you know, stuff like that. Did you get it right? Have you been professional? Hopefully you haven't taken any drugs, but you have to be responsible for what you've done. That photograph there, that's sort of trying to illustrate your peer group is actually quite important, actually, because the peer group that you train with will help develop your good habits, and you learn from your peer group learns from you. There's an exchange of information within the group that goes on below a coaching level. If somebody's got some really good habits in your group, it helps other players cope when they come under pressure. If they're seeing good things, they're more likely to do good things. So peer group has a big influence. If you have a player, if your best player is someone who loses from 19 more consistently, the chances are that your next players coming through will lose consistently at 19 more. There are different reasons for that, that's a big subject, but peer group actually has a big influence. So there are lots and lots of things that influence. So as a coach, the higher up the ladder you go, the more you have to look at your player and what the priorities are. So building a program for your player to improve their performance is actually complex. It's really quite complex. It starts off, it's reasonably simple because you're only responsible for the court, maybe a couple of hours a night, twice a week, whatever. That's okay. You know, you can improve them within the lines of the court, but even at that stage, you don't know what they're doing physically, maybe. You may be setting them the task, but you're not actually with them. You can write the best programs in the world physically, but if they're not going to do them to the right level of intensity, they're not going to get the benefit from it. So although they're coming in and saying they've done it, it's how well have they done it, what have they done? Because you're probably not going to be spending that time at the beginning. So, but as you go up the ladder, lots and lots of factors come into performance and planning for performance. So we talked a bit about winning and the objective of winning, and you were all talking about, yeah, it's got to be more about the performance, it's more about the performance, it's not the result. Yes, no, I don't know. I think that's a grey area for me. I don't think that's black and white. Because if you look at the top players in the world today, as I said the other day when Stuart was talking, we've known about those players from when they were 15 at the latest. Some of them as early as 11. We've known about them internationally. Infanon, we knew at 11 internationally that she was there and she was arriving. Mia Ordina, the age of 12, at 2-all in the final of the Human Cup winning. We know they're there and they're winning. So there is a winning trait as well. There are some winning habits that some people get very early and some people you have to work harder with to give it to them. Sina, we knew at 15 from Commonwealth Games in Melbourne. Lee Chong Wei, we knew at 15. He played his first Malaysian Open at 15. If you look at the 2000 World Junior Championships, Lee Chong Wei lost in the semi-final to Bao Chun Lai, who beat Lin Dan in the final. So we know, we were watching them, they were there, they were winning. So when you say the result doesn't matter, I understand what you're saying, but make sure you're saying it for the right reasons. Because actually, a lot of these players are identified because they're winning early. So what makes them winners? Which areas are there are they doing well? Because they're not all doing all of those things well at that age. So what have they got? Are the coaches analysing what they've got? How are they building them up? How do they take them to the next stage? This is performance planning. That's what I would say as performance planning. Nathan Robertson. Nathan Robertson is from my region in England. There was a rule at the time where you couldn't bring players onto the regional development programme until they were 15 years of age. And Andy Wood and myself, who were the coaches for that region at the time, fought like hell and got the rule changed and got an exception for Nathan Robertson, and we got him on at the age of 12. Chris Adcock and Gabby Adcock, when I went back to the UK, were 15 and 16. You couldn't come into the NBA because of area of responsibility for them being in the accommodation full time under the age of 18. It was difficult. There had to be an adult on the, it meant there had to be an adult on the premises full time. So the board of directors said no, they can't come into the national centres. So I said, no, we're going to put an adult in there. We're going to make sure there's an adult there and there's a rota, and we create a rota and we make sure there's always an adult in the building, and if the parents agree to it, we bring the parents down and put them in now. We put them in at 16, 17. 18 months later, they won England's only ever World Junior silver medal. It was the only ever medal. They had match points to win the World Champs because they came in early, because they'd been identified. Because they had traits.
Sorry? That was New Zealand, did that
exist? It was, yeah. They had match points in the final. So, there's all sorts of things here, but as I say, your job is to know your players. So I'm going to ask you, how well do you know your players? In what depth have you looked at your players? Okay. This we all know about since she was 11, 12. So, if I divide it up into, say, five areas we've identified, technical, tactical, physical, mental, lifestyle. Do you know your players? Do you think you do know your players? Okay, let's have a look at an example. I'm going to give you an example. I'm not going to give you the name. But these charts that you're about to see now are from a player who won the World Championship medal. Okay? And this is what happened. When I went back to England, to the National Centre, there were a lot of problems. You probably don't know all of these characters, but there were some very difficult players in the centre at the time. There was Simon Archer, Nathan Robertson, you'd have to probably say Gail Emms, Robert Blair,
Anthony Clark.
These are very, very high maintenance players. And on the coaching side, we had some very high maintenance coaches. So Rexy, Yvette, Lee J. Bock, from all different cultures with lots and lots of different ideas. Andy Wood with lots of different ideas again. It was coming in from the outside, coming back to manage it, I understood nothing that was happening on court. I did not understand this player was over here, this player was over here, this player was over here. I watched a men's doubles session when I went back in. The first session I sat down and watched the first morning I went into work was a men's doubles session. There were five players, there were two coaches, and they worked on three courts. And the two coaches were probably working harder than the players. They were having to hit so many shuttles, they always had to be on court because to get the right numbers for the exercises they were trying to do. Julian Robertson came off, I said to Julian, great session Julian, you've really improved that. He's the coach. Okay? What was happening there? He says, oh, you don't know, it's really good, they work really hard, they work really well. I said, but what's with the three courts? You could have done it on two courts, you could have done it even some stuff on one court. Oh no, because we can't put Blair on court with Archer, and we can't put Robertson on court with Blair, so they've got to be on three separate courts. Okay, that's good, that's going to work really well for us then, isn't it? You know? And that's the sort of situation you're walking back into. So then when I sit down and start talking to the coaches about the players and how we develop the players, Lee J. Bock, very, very famous coach, very, very good coach, has very, very strong ideas about this is how you do it. Brexit coming from Indonesia, a bit more laid back, but he's got a clear theory on doubles about what's required. Andy Wood, working on doubles, is a very, very good coach, had a completely different theory on what those same players needed. Yeah, Yvette, Chinese to Australia, to sports science, to lots and lots of good ideas, but very, very, very different from the other coaches. So when we start talking about the players, even the coaches aren't agreed on what's happening with the players. You know, they were responsible for different groups. Don't get me wrong, they weren't working all the time with the same players. There was some overlap with group sessions, but they all had responsibility. But the focus was more on about proving their theories and imposing their way of their style as being the best style than it was about looking at the players. But I'm not saying there was bad things happening, there were a lot of good things happening because you've got good players, you've got good coaches, you're going to get some good outcomes. But was it efficient? I'm not sure. In fact, no, I am sure it wasn't efficient. I changed that. I was sure it wasn't efficient. So I said, right, let's do an analysis of the players. Let's see where the players are. Let's have a look and see where they think they are. So I asked the coaches in those five different areas to agree on between themselves, to sit as a group and agree. I think it's between 15 and 20 questions for each of those five sections that they felt were really important. So, you know, can jump and be explosive for 3 sets? Is explosive on return of serve? Enjoys the situation at 19 or whatever in the different sections. So, coaches sat down, they had a great time, they actually really enjoyed it, and they wrote down all of these questions. But they were about to be brought out. So then we said, and then I said to all the players, got all the players in and said, right, I want you all to fill in all of these 5 forms. And to be fair, they all did it. They all bought into it and they all did it. Then I said to the coaches, right, I want you to fill in all 5 of those forms for all of your players. At that point, the coaches were going, what? Why have we got to do it? I'm going, and this is why they have to do it. So you can't see the questions on there, but it's like serve variety and third shot, return of short serve and fourth shot. So there's some different technical areas there. This is the master technical profile. So these are the questions that they came up with. This was for the doubles players actually. And the blue line that you see is the players' answers, and the green line is the coaches' answers. And what you see, moving around, there are some areas where they're not too bad, but these gaps here, between what the players' impression of where they are and the coaches' idea of where they are, shows to me that relationship is dysfunctional. That there's a breakdown in communication somewhere. Because you would expect, wouldn't you, that the coach and the player were on the same sort of line about where they were in these different technical areas, but they weren't. So to me, that's completely dysfunctional, where you have a player thinking that their footwork or their ability to finish in the forecourt is a 1, and I've got a coach putting it down as a 7, I've got a footwork at a 2, and a coach putting it down at 7. Well, what's in the coach's planning there? Because the athlete's clearly not confident in those areas, but the coach thinks actually there's no problem. So for me, that flags up that relationship is dysfunctional. So when I say, do you know your players? That's what I mean. Your impression of the player might not be the impression that they've got, and who's the most important one in this relationship? The player. The player's impression is more important than the coach. The coach actually might be right, and with discussion and doing a couple of the right exercises, the player might think, well, actually, yeah, you're right, I'm not that bad in that area, maybe there's another area we need to work on. But the perception there is completely different. So there's a breakdown in communication somewhere.
Is there any reason why the green line's always running
in the line? Well, that's a good question. Let's have a look at the next one. It's something to do with the character of this player. That I think that this particular coach, when we come to the mental when we come to the mental one, you'll see the difference. So again here, this is technical. Sorry, I just don't know. I've doubled one and not put the other one on. Okay, but you get the idea. So this is the mental profile. So in terms of ability to switch off between matches, relaxation and recovery, look at this. And then here, we've got the athlete actually thinks they do a really good job in preparation, whereas the coach doesn't think they're doing such a good job. And again, you've got big discrepancies, both inside and outside the line, between where the coach thinks the player is and where the player thinks the player is. And that can't work. That doesn't work.
Just a question, can we possibly get templates for something?
Go and do your own. Seriously, it's such a simple exercise.
I understand.
This is relevant to this player who won a world medal. Yep. These questions are relevant to them.
I guess you're saying there would be slightly different.
Pick the questions that are relevant to your players. Pick the areas that are relevant to your players. Just jot down 10 questions.
Yeah.
Make your spider's web and stick the results in and see how close you are. Do a 360. Put the parents in there. Put another line in there and put the parents in there. See what the parents' impression is. Because if you're working with kids who are still dependent on the parents in terms of transport, funding, etc., their impression is equally, possibly even more important. So put the parents on there. Or if there's another big influence on the program, get them to do the same thing, make it a full 360. But make the questions up for yourselves. Seriously. I wasn't being bad, yeah, of course you can have a look at this, you can have a presentation, but again, you're seeing differences in terms of physical, you see some differences, not as many differences, but you get the idea.
I'd just love to hand that to the psychologists working with the...
Well, we have 2 sports psychologists. And on the mental one, I got them to do it as well.
Yeah.
We have 2 sports psychologists working on the programme, as I maybe have time to show you later. But again, here, on the lifestyle, again, there's too much difference between what the coach thinks and what the player thinks. There's too much difference for it to be an efficient relationship that's really as productive, where you're maximising productivity.
Have you done it the other way around, what the actual player thinks of the coach and performance? Well,
we did these sort of, they're not exactly 360 reviews, but we call it 3, but we did them every 3 months. And little by little, the lines came together. After 12 months, actually, there was, I could see, visibly see, that communication had improved, and therefore I felt that there was a more effective working relationship and a more effective environment being created around that player.
Just on the comment of 360s for coach, yes, I think it's important that at a certain stage of a coach's career, that the coach is also do 360s for their personal development.
Yes.
But you do have to track with a little bit of caution when you go, depending on the environment that you're working in, to give parents. Of course, it's important for the coach to get feedback, but you know, it depends on when you're working at the very high end, I think, you know, definitely, you've got to. Yeah, I don't know what you mean, your opinion, but it's quite a...
360 for me?
Yeah, from players to the coach, because they're all... you know what it's like when you're a player, you have a... It's not until you start coaching where you actually understand some of the stuff that happens. You've got to tread a little bit of caution in terms of if you do that, what the questions are and how you...
Yeah.
What the purpose is of, you know, what the purpose is, because you've got to... There's a fine line between, respect, authority, you know, cultural player relationship, and whether the balance.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know whether that makes any sense.
Yeah, it does. But a lot of it is that culturally, a lot of coaches still feel that if you talk to them, I don't want to sound bad here, they'll feel that it's their program, which is completely wrong.
Yeah, that's what we were talking about, Brandon, wasn't it? Is that it's like we are just there to provide. We're not dominating, we're the ones who
That's not even a discussion, but if you talk to half the coaches out here, they run the program.
Yeah.
Not the players. And the players actually don't have input into the program. And I think we're seeing that a little bit with the shift of balance in the world of badminton at the moment. I think we're beginning to see that. There's a couple of classics on here that I'll point out. So this is a complete guess from the coach about how they sleep in tournaments. Because they've never asked. So they just put, oh, eight. And actually the player had big problems, we signaled out from this, that the player had big problems sleeping. They were okay when they were home in their own environment, but they didn't sleep very well in hotels, they didn't sleep very well sharing a room. And for them it was actually a really important issue, but the coach had never even asked how he slept at a tournament. They'd never even considered, because all they were worried about was preparing the match that day and getting into the match, getting into the preparation, getting them into warm up, make sure they get up, etc. Make sure they're there for the practice, then make sure they're on time for the match. They warm up properly, they do the video and everything. And actually, without even knowing, the player's absolutely knackered because they haven't slept for 2 nights. Because they've never asked the question. Which is really quite sort of basic to know that about your player. Are you sleeping? How do you sleep? And, you know, just that little tick chart, I'm sure you've all seen it, where you have a travel diary with players, where you travel with players, each day you ask them to tick the box about how they slept, just to see if they slept okay. And if you have 2 or 3 nights where they haven't slept okay, then you need to do something about it. Yeah, you need to flag it up. And it's just simply asking the right question and being aware of your role. Very, very often coaches get very narrow on this and about the badminton, but they don't lose the match because of the badminton, they lose it because of the environment. As you said earlier on, the environment's absolutely critical. So, this type of exercise, there's lots of different ways of doing this sort of exercise, and you can involve different people. But my challenge will always be, how well do you know your player? And if you're working with that player 1 hour a week, you don't need to know them that well. If you're working with them 4 or 5 hours a week, yeah, you need to know them a little bit better. If you're taking responsibility for their performance, you need to know them very well. And you need to be talking to them about things other than their forehand net shot or their jump smash. You need to be talking about other areas, and you need to be looking at other areas about them, how can they be most effective. Okay, does that sort of make sense? It was dysfunctional, and I think if we went out there and did this exercise, you would find a lot of dysfunctional relationships between coaches and players. Mm-hmm. I think that the players that are being successful today, I think you'll find a lot of functioning relationships, which are more analytical. And I would say within 12 months, we improved the environment within Milton Keynes tenfold, because by improving communication, by involving the support staff more. And if you've got time, I'll show you a little video in a minute about the support staff. But that's an important, for me, that's very, very important, and it's critical to success. So moving on to performance analysis. So if we start to think more about specifically what this session was about, and I apologize that I've not got to that yet, in terms of video, how can you use video? What different ways can you use it? There's a few answers on the board, don't bother reading it, but in what areas would you use it? How do you use video? Do any of you use video? That's the first question. You use video?
Great.
What do you use it for?
Technical.
You use it for technical. Are you using video, or are you using Darfish, or just straight video?
Oh, yes,
slow-mo on iPhone, okay, yeah. So technical, there's some free tools out there these days online that are really good for that. What else do you use it for?
What were those things, the three things that you were talking about?
What are the three things? We'll come back to the three things. What else do you use it for? What else do you use video for?
Physical.
Movement.
Possibly, yeah. You could look how movement breaks down.
Snapshot from the beginning.
Well, you can demonstrate at the end about the lunge at the beginning and the lunge at the end, if the lunge is balanced, etc. Yeah, you can see that, yeah, okay. What else? What else are you using video for?
Body language.
Yeah, okay.
Not personally, but like software like Video Tag, right now it's big in volleyball for Australia. So they analyse, you know, every shot, whether it's a winner, what the follow-up is, all situations like that.
So is that self-analysis or opponent analysis?
Both.
Nice.
Exactly. So you can use it for self-analysis or you can use it for opponent's analysis. What else can you use it for? Wow. Maybe we have to get up and go for a job around here and get some good to the brains. What else can you use video for?
Especially just being able to be played.
The two players, so teamwork. Yeah? Go on. Keep going. What else can you use video for?
Demonstration,
very good. Very good. So with young players, actually you can walk around with an iPad now with a Lee Chong Wei joint smash load and say, actually, you want it to look like that. That's what I'm not. That'd be a little bit of a you can actually walk around saying, look, you need to extend like this, and you can have loaded on your iPhone if you're really clever. You'll have the BWF clips, technical clips on there. You have the technical clips on there loaded, and you can say, actually, this is what you're trying to get. So see it, do it. We talked about it yesterday. Sometimes they need to see it, because then they can do it. You telling them, look, you need to get your arm out straighter. Verbally, it's very difficult for them to grasp the concept. Visually, it's much easier for them to grasp the concept. And I really like iPad. I really like the fact I can carry the image around with me now and actually just click to a technique and say, if I've got a real problem, I can show them. And I think that's a really good tool. Yeah, that's going to be a video. More video uses, come on. Think outside the box, come on.
I guess you can log instead of using journals and tick the boxes, you actually get players to log what they're thinking.
So they start video diaries nowadays rather than the diaries. I mean, these guys know Tracy Allen very well. Right from the age of 13, Tracy wrote down every match. At the end of every match, she wrote down notes on the opponent, she wrote down notes on herself, how she felt, and she did that all the way through her career. Tracy's quiet, she doesn't talk about her own self very much, but she was very, very professional. She had limited physical tools to work with. Quarterfinal of the Olympics and two world quarterfinals in Commonwealth gold. When you look at Tracy, you're never going to guess that she did all that, you know? But she was very, very professional. Very, very professional. And she really had detailed knowledge on every opponent she ever played. Half of them had retired, but they were still in Tracy's book. Yeah.
Statistics of the match and
statistics. You can take statistics from video, which is good.
And also, I guess you can use video to, review. Maybe play.
Review. Really important. Really important. Sometimes it's really important to get the players to sit and watch them themselves because, actually, have you all watched yourself play on video? It's a serious question. Have you watched yourself play badminton on video?
Yes. I was at the World Junior Champs in 2008 in India, and again, probably didn't do my homework, but Blair had played a game and we videoed it. And I said, oh, come on, sit down. I wasn't a player from who I had a lot of contact with. I was not in the center of the train. You know, I had to do it, so decentralized and come together for a tournament. And I sat down, so I have a look at this, and it was really quiet and didn't sense. I said, what's that? I said, oh, it's the first time I've ever seen that play. So what is the right time of introducing the video analysis? Maybe not, because it was, for him, it was like, He didn't know what he was seeing, but he never ever seen himself play. And I was just making the assumption, because we're using it so much, that he would ever see himself play.
But I'm very old, so when I was playing, there was no video. It was black and white TV. But towards the end of my career, I did sneak on by a fluky draw. I actually got on a televised match. It was shown on TV. and I watched it the next day on TV, and I was watching it, and I couldn't figure out which one I was on the court.
That was also black and white.
I had never realised how crap I looked on court constantly. Oh. It was unbelievable. That was not the impression I had of what I was doing on court. That was nothing to do with what I would say. That's not me. Who's that blanky person? Who's that playing that doubles there? It's not me. Who's that lanky guy with no legs? Honestly, that was really not my perception of what I was on court or what I did. And I thought it was on slow mo as well. That was another problem. But the perception and watching themselves on video and analysing what they do, again, seeing is really, really important because players see and they do.
Yeah.
They're not good listeners normally, athletes. Well, and that's the same in all sports.
Yeah, Mikey's all done, so see and do plays a big part. And with permission of the parents, of course, we consent forms being signed and we do take video images.
Yeah.
And from time to time, we actually compare those images for them to see how far they've come across, or sometimes how slack they've been. They've made no improvement, or to some extent even,
it's really interesting. Those of you that are there any Apple freaks in the room? Anyone with Apple computers? Anyone with Apple? Yeah. I mean, the editing, the free editing program on Apple these days is unbelievable. You can do split screen. You can have your player doing a jump smash and you can have Chong Wei on the other side on a split screen. And it's even I can manage to do it. It takes me longer than most kids to do, but I can handle that editing. And you can do so many things with it that are really, really neat. It's really easy now. Whereas when I was running England, we had two full-time people doing this. Yeah, there's a free editing suite on Apple computers, which is amazing. So, what else can you? I'm going to give you some then. I'm going to give you some other things you can use it for. You can get them to watch role models. You can get them to watch matches of players that they admire.
But that's typically what we did.
But that's video. That's use of video.
Yeah.
So people get too narrow on what you use video for. You can in Badminton England, we built up a library of all our potential opponents. So if someone was going to play someone in the draw, we had videos of all those opponents. Not only that, we had a breakdown of all those opponents. So for the doubles and mixed, we had clips of only Gao Lin returning serve from left court, Gao Lin returning serve from right court, Gao Lin returning flip from right court, Gao Lin returning flip from left court. And we had a breakdown of every opponent, a technical and tactical breakdown of every opponent, and we had it in the library, and we could pull those off. We could pull those off, so when our players were playing, we could do a very thorough tactical preparation for them, what to expect on first three. The singles players, we had all potential singles players relevant to the level of our players, of what they were doing in forehand corner here, what they were doing in round the head corner here, so they'd go on with visual cues. You know the session we did yesterday about how quickly you can see it? Well, if you've just watched it on the video, I can tell you see it quicker. So Tracy Harlan playing Zhang Nang. Going on to play Zhang Nang, Tracy would watch clips of Zhang Nang coming back into this corner and hitting her shots, coming back into this corner and hitting a shot before she'd gone to play. Tracy would be reading it quicker than it would have taken her maybe 10 points to get on that before without that preparation. It makes a big difference. So you've got the analysis there. Then we come down to some different ones. Then we come down to motivation. So how would you motivate a player by video? How would you motivate a player by use of video?
Rocky.
Music's really important. Music's mega important. You might need technical assistance from Mary Allen on that, because I'll show you that in a second. Yeah, over here, yeah. How would you motivate?
Demonstrate the improvements.
You can demonstrate an improvement, yeah, but, yeah.
360, when they had something that they were saying, oh, I'm actually not that good, and you had evidence to suggest otherwise.
Really, really important. Really, really important, and I'm going to show you the top secret clip on that. No. I'm going to show you a clip on something that we would do.
Alexander.
But it's low. This is low tech. This is typical low tech. This is unfortunately my hard drive crashed and I have to go back to the DVD. From, so you have to give me just a second.
Thank you.
clip for this tournament was called Troublemakers. So the first song was Troublemakers. Second one, I'm back and I'm ready to go because they're coming back from injury. So each tournament, each of our top pairs would have a motivational video made for them that they didn't know about, with music that they didn't know about, that was suitable for the themes of what they were doing. The coaches choose the key words, and the coaches choose the clips, and the motivational videos were put together for each event. Okay? For us, that was quite long to watch, you agree? For those two players, that's not very long. For those two players, it's positive reinforcement for the things that they can do well and should be looking to do well in that particular event, things that they've been focusing on in training, etc. So it's positive reinforcement. And it's very, very important, and it's a very, very important tool. Alongside that, before their first round match, they'll watch this, but they'll watch it after they've done the technical analysis of the opponent, so all the returns of serve, the types of attack, all the areas that are broken down in the library for that pair that they're going to play. So there'll be a tactical preparation, then they'll probably be left alone with the motivation video to have a look at it. As positive reinforcement, yes, they can deliver all the things that we've talked about tactically. Now, everybody talks about tactical analysis and the breakdown and everything. It's really interesting, but for players it's quite dry. Motivational videos bring it alive. And as you go through the rounds, what we do is re-edit overnight, so it can be re-edited overnight to include highlights from the match the day before. So actually it's things that you've done well the day before that you need to do the next day. So it's reinforced throughout the tournament, it's built up, or it's some bits are taken out, some bits are added. But always there's that element of trying to put them on court in the right frame of mind. Okay? We would use video like that. We'd use it for all team meetings. For all team meetings, we'd have a clip ready about the team. And the themes that the coaches felt were important for that particular team event would be included in the video. And then if we got through to what we felt was a critical match, so Sedilla Cup semi-final, for example, then there's a surprise video that's been prepared. I've got a whole string of them that we never used because we lost. But there was something prepared that was surprising and fun for the players before the semi-final, what we find before the final of Europeans or Commonwealth semi-final Sedilla Cup. There would be a video in the box, in the pocket, that we could pull out that had some funny images of players or maybe had some messages from a good look from family, for example, on there before a big match, to make it a little bit more emotional, try and build a little bit of an emotional connection between the players before a big team match. So you can use video in many, many, many different ways. You've just got to be inventive with it. And now, to be honest, with Apple in particular, but I'm sure others have got it as well, you can actually do it yourself reasonably quickly. Whereas we need a team to deliver that. But it's really, it's a really interesting area as to how to use it. But people tend to think in a very limited way about use of video. You can use it for self-analysis, you can use it for on-court analysis, you can use it for opponent analysis, you can use it for education. And you can use it for motivation, and that's just a stupid line at the bottom, but it's about what extra can you give through that clip to your player that might make that much difference. Might make that much difference. So it's being a little bit inventive with video. Maybe that's not the presentation you were waiting to see about it, but actually it's really important. And moving on to this ownership, I mean, who is responsible? We talked about this earlier on. Is it the coach? Is it the athlete? As you move through, your role changes. At the beginning, it's almost teacher-pupil. Then it becomes coach-athlete. It's a more active relationship. And then it becomes athlete, and you become almost a mentor. You want to be taking a back seat. If you're getting it right, you're taking more of a back seat. You're there. You're advising. You're advising. You're adding that extra little inch. Okay? And at the end of it, if your players haven't got pride, they probably won't win. And you see it so many times in critical situations where players are looking outside the court for support. There's some really good examples in tennis at the moment. players who are continually looking at their box, where their family, where their coaches, where their physio are, where their sports psychologist is. Drives me nuts.
Yes.
Drives me nuts.
Did he win yesterday?
No, of course.
Sorry.
Personal responsibility and developing excellence. At the end of the day, it's down to the player to make the most of their circumstances and their logistics. There are a lot of players achieve success in badminton from not very strong financial backgrounds. There are a lot that come from strong financial backgrounds, but it's not a prerequisite. But what is a prerequisite is that the players eventually take responsibility for their own project, and your job is to guide them to that position. Is to guide them towards being independent. You don't want a dependent athlete. It might, for a while, actually be a nice sensation to have someone, a good player, being dependent on you, but actually it's not a very healthy situation. In the long run, it's not a healthy situation. Because at 19 or 1 in the third, they need to take responsibility for that. You can't do it. You can't do it. Only they can do it. And if you've got your program right and you've got your coaching right, they will enjoy 19 or 1 in the third. They will thrive on it. That's what they train for. This is my job. This is my day job. 19 or 1 in the third, fantastic. I've got a chance of going through, I'm still in this. They should thrive in that situation, if you've got it right. Not be scared of it, not be looking around for outside help. So, when I say making the most of available resources, there are lots of different ones. So, you know, different players need different things at different stages of their career. So, where you've got limited finances and limited support, you have to make decisions and prioritise where your money goes sometimes, you know, and there's physio, medical, strength and conditioning, physiology, nutrition. Administration is really important. Administration in terms of, it takes time to get visas and book travel, etc. So administrative support is important. Psychology, lifestyle support, performance analysis, coaches, peer group, funding. There are so many factors. There are so many factors. And players and coaches need to prioritise and make sure that you're getting access to the right services at the right time for your athlete. And that, again, comes full circle back to you need to know your athlete and you need to understand. You need to understand what the needs are and you need to prioritise those needs. Okay, that's a whistle-stop tour. There are other videos, but I'm about out of time. But it's performance analysis is a really, really interesting area. Really, really interesting area. The difference actually technically, tactically and physically out there are minimal actually. Minimal. This week when you sit and watch, they're all technically good, they're all physically good. Most of them are mentally pretty strong, most of them are tactical. It's not a complicated game, badminton really. It's quite simple. It is quite a simple game. People try to make it complicated, but actually there's not that many things you can do. It's reasonably simple. And the difference comes in on the mental side, the decision-making side, and very often in the preparation. So you need to take the blinkers off, have a good look at your athlete, get to know your athlete, prioritise what they need at different stages, they need different things at different stages of their development, and get that right, and you've got a chance. That is that presentation. I'm open for questions if anybody's got any questions.
Ian, just quickly, because of course the motivation, I know there was a significant amount of time, I don't know whether it's still like it, but the English team had a full-time video analysis person travelling full-time with the team.
Yeah.
To obviously do other things, are they still?
They've got a service in Milton Keynes, they haven't got a full-time travel anymore. Personally, with the level of squad that I had, that's what I'm talking about. But I prioritised that over other things because I felt that was a game breaker. I think that's something that at that period, in that period when we were, so there's a video there at Madrid when we had three finals. So in Madrid World Championships 2006 in the finals, there were seven Chinese finalists and three English finalists. Rest of the world zero in the finals. And I think a lot of that was down to how professional we were in our preparation. And a lot of it was down to the work that we were doing, actually, in analysis of opponents and actually actually motivational side of our players and the preparation of our players. I think that made a difference, so that's where I chose to invest my money. I invested heavily in performance analysis. We have the latest software, which I think now is freely available everywhere. But we have software available in terms of games analysis, which nobody had. We work with a software company and we develop something specific for badminton. I think that was probably the first one. There are a number now that can be used for badminton to analyse tactically and technically. But at the time, I think that gave us an edge, so I put a lot of our funding into that. But that meant that funding didn't go into other areas, so you can't please everybody all the time. But it was my job to prioritise where the money did go. And I think that at the time that was money well spent because it gave us an advantage over all of the countries at that time. Any other questions? Stunned silence. Or is it boredom? I don't know. You tell me.
Perhaps I mean it's important to kind of maybe you touched a lot about what was done the high end with the England players at that stage, but break it back down. I mean, as an example, I've got an 8-year-old daughter. All kids nowadays are technically pretty savvy. She has a gymnastics competition, made a little video of her beam routine. And this is not deliberately done so that because his parent wanted to sit down after she finished and go and watch this stuff. No, but what I'm saying is if you have young players, you can watch it and you can actually help. So, look at what do you think you did really well? And like, it's a motivational thing for them to see themselves and get more awareness of what they're doing. And it can actually help tremendously improving small little areas. So for players, it can be done at the absolute grassroots level. It's perfect. I mean, you don't need game break, you don't need expensive software, you just need your, I don't know what Samsung Galaxy or about, but it's just that whole line.
I haven't got an Apple computer, but I've just seen people play with the editing now. I wanted something doing for a coaching routine, and I sat down with a friend who'd got an Apple, and I said, I want to do this. And thinking that I was going to be there for about 3 hours, we were there for about 15 minutes. It was amazing. It's an amazing tool, it's an amazing machine.
And the kids might be better at it anyway, because a lot of players do it themselves.
They can play with it, a lot of players do it themselves now. A lot of them travel with Apples. They just ask one of their mates in the stand to press the button, they press the button, they go away, and afterwards they look at it. But it's right, I mean, even in those days, we fed all of these videos, we fed them all down the system. So all the junior players coming down at the time, looking what we were doing with those top players, with Tracy, with Anthony Donner, with Nathan and Gail. On the men's single side, Gaffer had some big wins. He had about 4 top 10 wins from nowhere, really. But what we did was, all that video stuff we fed down the system, we used on all the junior camps, we showed them the motivational videos. It became aspirational to get into the senior team. When you had a motivational video made of yourself, you made it in England, You got on there. I remember going into the 2006 games with a pair called Roebuck and Palethorpe. I don't know whether you remember them. It was Christian Roebuck and Ian Palethorpe, Scouse, he was called. And they qualified for the Worlds, and they actually got the last seeding spot. They got the 16th spot. A couple of pairs, countries had more pairs. They ranked about 21 in the world. Good, they were okay. And they got that 16th seeding spot, and we had a look at it and said, they've got to have a video for this. They didn't get the 16th seeding spot. We thought they'd got it, and they didn't get it. And when they got there, first round, they got the Polish pair, Logosz and Matusiak, first round. And we'd got loads of video on them. So we said, right, well, we're going to target this match. It's actually going to be one of the first matches that's on for England. We're going to target it. We did a motivational video for them. We did all the opponent analysis for them. They would have had the opponent analysis anyway. But then when we gave them the video, when we gave them the motivation and walked out the room, their faces when they came out the room were a picture. And they went on and won. They won that match, so they knocked them out. They were seeded, I think they were about 9 in the world at the time, the Poles. And actually, when people still ask me questions about the 2006 World Champs, that was actually a key moment. That was a key moment. Because we could have lost the first match that anybody played in the week, and the atmosphere is different. As it is, 2 really popular guys in the squad who weren't going to win a medal, but they won a great match for them, that was their final. They went through to the last 16 of the World Champs. And actually, it set the ball rolling. It's, you get momentum. You get momentum in matches, but you also get momentum in tournaments. And then Smith went on and won, and then Tracy went on and won, and suddenly on day one, the ladies' doubles went on and won, and then suddenly on day one, we played five, won five. The big players hadn't gone on yet because they had buys in those days, but the whole thing was, we were in it. We were there, we were in it, and everybody was together. We had, at the time, we had 24 players qualified. It's a big group. 24 players in that group, which is difficult to manage, particularly if a lot of them have lost on the first day. So things really ran for us and things started well and momentum started rolling. Then when people were losing, nobody wanted to go home. They were offering to pay hotel rooms to stay, to support, and they were offering to stay and do the video for Hannah, because we've got four cameras there. People were offering to pay for the hotel rooms and stay in the group because it had been, we've got a positive thing rolling. So it started well and it finished pretty well.
How did those actual 360s, you said you had a lot of different personalities, how did that actually help with, like, this, my personal experience in national teams or just sporting or things, is personality clashes coming from everywhere. So how much did those things actually make it possible for at least a professional working relationship in national team situations?
Massively. But there are some relationships that will never work. So Blair and Robertson, they were never going to share a room and go for a beer. You know, that was never going to happen. It was how to manage it. It was how to manage it. And that was my job. That wasn't the coach's job. That was my job. I had to take that away, but I had to get those two to agree to be 100% professional in terms. And if I needed them to hit together on court and warm up, they had to hit together on court and warm up. If they didn't, they both went home. But if either of them refused, they would have gone.
Would it be true to say that actually a lot of these champions actually have strong personalities?
Yes. Of course they do.
Of course they do. I don't know. I think some of the Chinese world champions, I think, haven't had particularly strong characters. I think they've been led. And I think when you get Danish winners and when you get English winners at that level, I think normally they are incredibly strong characters and on the whole incredibly difficult people to manage because they needed to be so tough to come through. And the Danes have just as many strong characters as the English, if not more so over the years. And the management of those is very, very difficult. That's a full-time role. On trips I'll coach, but in Milton Keynes, my role was management only. I went back as a coach and I ended up as a manager.
I love that with English Premier League football, just football in general, they're not coaches, they're managers.
Yeah.
But you can also tell that, you know, just recently when Denver won the Thomas Cup for the first time ever, that is actually the thing that's coming out of that. That they say they respect the former Danish team who's been there and probably even having better chances of winning in the past. But what they're saying now, this was a team, and that's the whole thing about it. So what you're saying is the characters before probably had, you know, there was a lot more balance in the teams early on than it wasn't this
musical. Yeah. Character is quite such an important talented component as well. Certainly, if you're in Europe and you're looking at people who can be competitive with the Asians, if you look at those who are competitive, they are all very, very strong characters. And they bring something different to the game. So if they didn't, they wouldn't be able to compete. You know, I look at Caroline Marine and her, you know, on-court attitude, because you've got to separate what she does on court from off-court. But what we see is obviously only on-court stuff. But the thing is, she brings something different, you know. Going back as far as the market or whatever it is, was whoever from Europe has always been competitive and always been characters, always been strong. Yeah.
It actually really annoys me the amount of criticism that Carolina gets.
Yeah, me too.
It really annoys me. Because she's found a way of getting inside her own sense. She does it really well, because off court that's not Carolina.
No.
That's not her at all. But on court persona is something that's been built specifically for her. It's built for purpose, shall we say. And it's really, really clever and effective about how they've done that.
Here's a loaded question that you probably won't answer, but at what point should a sport not accept that behaviour when you've got Maria Sharapova or Azarenka in tennis or Kyrgios? maybe my views on
sport. I think there's rules there. As a coach, I'm not talking BWF now, but as a coach, of course, I know the system very well in these tournaments. So before the umpires have a meeting before the tournament with the referee, and each referee has a different idea on how the umpire should umpire. Okay? Now, if you get to know that very well, it gives you a small advantage because you know the briefing. And if you've got your country umpire that's in that briefing, you check with him what the briefing was. Because you know more what you can get away with on service.
Yeah.
Because there was a point in time where referees were saying, if the service, a false serve, if it's a false serve, I don't want you to call it if they're sort of short, but if they flip, even if that's not a fault, you fault it.
Yeah.
You fault it. Which is absolutely nuts to me.
Yeah.
But it meant it took. There was a time, and it was before I worked for BWF, there was a time where referees were basically telling umpires that when players serve short, if it was a fault every time, they didn't want the game stopped. With fault, because it's unattractive. So the instruction was that if they were only serving short, you didn't fault it, but the moment they flick, you call fault. Yeah? Now, for me, if I know that as a coach, that takes all the pressure off my players. They can't go ridiculous, but they haven't got to worry about serving short. They can lift it up. If they serve the short, they're okay. But they can't flick under pressure then.
Yeah, just up to the front, not this way, this has perform every flick shot in the world.
Yeah,
and there's small things like that. So, in answer to your question, it doesn't bother me because there's a set of rules there. If badminton or tennis want to change the rules, they can change the rules. But until they change the rules, why am I going to change my players' behaviour?
Mm-hmm.
I had that issue with a number of those players where the rules were changed in BWF because of England. Because we got so many yellow and red cards, eventually they brought financial penalties in for it. Because they realised that during the season, when they did the analysis at the end of the season, we got something like double the number of the next most country, and in 1 year, we nearly had the total of the rest of the country at Super Series level. Yeah? And they eventually realised they've got to do something about it. Whereas some of my players I know need to vent on the court. They needed to vent at certain times on the court. They needed to throw a racket, they needed to shout, they needed to do something. And you've seen some of these characters and some of you will remember them. They needed to do that. I don't care if they got a yellow card at that time. I really didn't care. That's what they felt they needed to do. They were experienced athletes, they did it. Did people like it in the crowd? No. Did it wind crowds up? Yes. Did it wind opponents up? I hope so. But it was within the rules. It was within the rules. If BWF or ITF want to change the rules, got no problem. But until then, I'll play within that set of rules that are in front of me, and I don't feel bad about that. Same with the service, you know. I was watching, we were playing some of the Danes at the time, service, which was just ridiculous. We were serving about 18 inches lower than they were, and I was saying to them,
18 inches?
Get it, serves up. Come on, boys.
Maybe someone has a long torso.
If they can do it, we can. Practice it. I would always bring one of our international players in before a tournament to have a look at the serves, and he'd say, yeah, they're all fault. I'd say, great, thanks very much. Let me know if the briefing changes at the tournament, please.
Yeah. I think maybe Brendan also going back to your question is like there is a line and athletes, good athletes will always push to, and they will always be on edge and they will go sometimes over. Yeah. That's actually that's just true. But I guess where the difference lies is when throwing a record, breaking a record, venting. There's a difference between when you do that because you're angry with yourself and how you do that, or when you're being disrespectful to your opponent. And that's where always, for me personally, that's where always the line is. I don't have a problem with one of the players like coach getting losing the plot on the court. But if they start chucking the record at an opponent or doing something, that's where the line, of course, is.
Well, one of the things, one of my pet hates is after the match, is when the match finishes, I hate seeing players go to coaches before they go to opponent.
Yes.
I will always instruct. I always instructed English players, no matter how excited they were, you have to go to your opponent first. You have to shake hands, then you can do what the hell.
But everyone does it.
I don't care. No, well they don't. They actually, BWF have changed the rule. It's a fine then. There's no match without opponent. You have to show respect to your opponent. That's one of the basics of sport. Without opponent, there's no match. There's no sport. So your first call was opponent, and that one I always assisted on. And I had several players who wanted. Who had started doing it the other way around because they'd seen people do it. No, I mean, you push them back now. The line actually is slight, for me, is slightly different. The problem that I have with that, the only problem I had with my players doing it was explaining it to the junior players about why I let them do that. Why I wasn't bothered when Archer would random rally on the court and explaining that I didn't want to see 16-year-olds doing that. I didn't want him as a role model particularly. I don't think he was a good role model. But he won Olympic and world medals. He did what he needed to do for his character. But what I didn't want, what I did say is you don't need to copy that aspect of his game. That's his personality, that's not your personality. You don't want his personality. No, but you know what I mean? Maybe you want his toughness on court, you want his grittiness on court, you want his competitiveness, but you don't want his personality, do you? No, nobody wants his personality. Yeah. Okay, anything else? Good?
Thank you.
Any questions? Come see me individually, no problem. Thanks.
Thank you.